بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق والمرسلين، سيدنا وحبيبنا وشفيعنا وقدوتنا وقرة أعيننا ونور قلوبنا وسندنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. All praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the choicest of blessings upon our master Sayyiduna, our beloved Habibuna Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jamaatul Muslimin, my topic that I wish to address today bi-idhnillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala is very much a sickness that has befallen and entered our communities, something that the Quran speaks out against with much harshness, something which our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke out against. The topic, Jamaatul Muslimin, is that of ghiba. And many of us might be familiar with this term ghiba. But before reaching the actual topic and the meaning of ghiba, and mentioning verses of the Quran and a hadith that speaks out against ghibah and what a bad sin it is, I want to speak about tahdhirul lisan. You know, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam warning us about protecting the tongue, because this essentially is the major problem. Most of the difficulties we find in society, most of the differences of opinion, most of the arguments that we have, most of the battles that we are fighting, most of the cases why we find families that are split apart, is because man has lost the ability to control the tongue. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in a tradition narrated by Sahl ibn Sa'din radiyallahu ta'ala an, that whoever, man yadman li Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said the person who guarantees that he is able to protect that which lies between his jaws, referring to the tongue. Protect it in terms of that which you eat, yes. But more importantly, protect that which lies between his jaws, referring to the tongue. He protects what he speaks. He is punctual in taking note of what he's actually saying. He thinks before he speaks, and this is a extremely important quality that you and I need to adapt, Jamaatul Muslimin. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that person who is able to protect his tongue, he doesn't just speak. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Adman lahul jannah." A person who guarantees me that he'll protect his tongue, I guarantee that this person will enter into Jannah. He will enter paradise. It's a great virtue. You know, and a simple recipe. Control your tongue and the Prophet guarantees you Jannah. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala an narrates that the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, speaking about the danger of not controlling the tongue. Abu Huraira narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَإِنَّ الرَّجُلَ indeed a man لَا يَتَكَلَّمُ بِالْكَلِمَةِ, a man will utter one word. Now, remember Jamaatul Muslimin that sometimes I think I am deserving of saying this word. And I think I am deserving of speaking ill about my Muslim brother. And we're coming to look at some of the talbis, the ways that shaitan deceives us in speaking ill of Muslims. You know, we're coming to look at that later. And I don't want, and I speak to myself first, let us not tell and inform and say to ourselves that when I speak of somebody, I have the right to do so because I have certain objectives in mind. These are all trickery from shaitan. Pondering the words of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and ask myself and use this as a yardstick before I open my mouth again regarding any Muslim. Let me reflect in these words. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَا يَتَكَلَّمْ بِالْكَلِمَةِ, a man, he will utter one word. مَا يَظُنُّ أَنَّهَا تَبْلُغْ مَا بَلَغَتْ, he has no idea how damaging and how far reaching that single word is. And today we see this. We see it with our SMSs, we see it with Facebook, we see it with Twitter, we see it with the various social platforms. I type in one word, I push enter, the whole world sees it. The Prophet said he doesn't realize how far reaching that word of his is. And on account of that word, فَهُوَ يَهْوِي بِهَا, on account of that single word that he utters, he will fall 70, سَبْعِينَ خَرِيفًا فِي النَّارِ, for 70 years he will fall deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper into the fire of Jahannam. One word. Today we don't utter words, we utter sentences. We utter paragraphs. I have a special meeting, a special gathering, so I can speak ill about my Muslim brother. He does this and he does that. And this is not the attitude of believers, Jamaat al-Muslimin. And we come to discuss more of that in a bit, bi-ithnillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in another hadith informing us and impressing upon us the importance of protecting the tongue, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to his companions, should I not inform you of the head of this matter, the head of deen, Ra'asul Amr? Should I not inform you of the pillar of this faith, of Islam? Should I not inform you of Dhirwatu Sanami, the pinnacle of Islam? And the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum respond, indeed, please inform us, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he then says that Salah is the Ra'asul Amr al-Islam. That the head of this faith is submitting yourself over to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وعموده الصلاة, the pillar of this faith is praying your salah. وذروة سنامي, its pinnacle is striving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, spreading the word of Allah, making the word of Allah high. لتكون كلمة الله هي العليا, الجهاد في سبيل الله. This is the pinnacle of this faith. Then Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says to us that, should I not inform you what will make you firm in all of these aspects? أَلَا أُنَبِّيُكُمْ بِمَلَاكِ الْأَمْرِ كُلِّهِ. And the companions رضي الله تعالى عنهم, they respond, please do inform us, our Messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, what will he grant us? Steadfastness in this entire faith. What will make us solid? What will make our foundation strong? And Muhammad, our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, he takes out his tongue from his mouth and he says, كُفَّ عَنْكَ هَذَا, protect this. Protect this tongue. Protect his tongue. And then the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they say, Ya Rasulullah, wa inna lamu'akhadhuna bima natakallam bih. Will we be taken to task by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that which we speak? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he responds, and these words, Jamaatul Muslimin, we need to come to a point in our lives where we stop making excuses. We need to reach a point where I stop passing the buck to someone else. We need to reach a point in my life where I stop trying to justify my actions. I need to reach a point in my life when I sit down to myself and I say, Abdurrahman, listen to the advices of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and implement it in your life. Don't look for excuses. This words of him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his words, it applies to me before it applies to anyone else. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that وَهَلْ يَكُبَّ النَّاسَ فِي النَّارِ عَلَى هُجُوهِهِمْ أَوْ عَلَى مَنَاخِرِهِمْ إلا حصائد ألسنتهم. When they want to know, will they be taken to task for that which they speak? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says that, is it not that the main reason that will cause people to be flung into the fire of Jahannam face first, the main reason is going to be إلا حصائد ألسنتهم, that which comes from their tongues. Now these are strong words from our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Jamaatul Muslimin, I want to look briefly at the meaning of ghiba. What does ghiba mean? Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he describes this, arrafaha. He defines it for us in a prophetic tradition. When the Prophet says to his companions, do you know what is ghiba? And when they respond, Allah and Allah's message and his best, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says that, dhikruka akhaka bima yakra. For you to mention and speak of your brother, to speak of anything about him that he dislikes. To speak of him, regarding such a thing that he dislikes. It's a very broad definition. And that's what ghiba is. It's something that is broad. And how many of us, we tend to be guilty of it. Al-Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he further defines what ghiba is. And he says that mentioning your brother, mentioning him and speaking about him regarding something that he dislikes. And then Imam Nawawi says, irrespective whether it refers to the physical body of that person, irrespective whether it refers to the deen of that individual, irrespective whether it refers to the dunya, the worldly affairs of that individual, irrespective whether it refers to the self of that individual, irrespective whether it refers to khulqihi, his outer appearance, irrespective whether it refers to khulqihi, his inner qualities, irrespective whether it refers to his wealth, irrespective whether it refers to his parents, irrespective of whether it refers to his children, whether it's his wife, whether it's his servants, whether it's clothes, whether it's the way he moves about, whether it's his harshness or his strictness, speaking anything about him that he dislikes is considered to be ghibah. And then our scholars, they are unanimous by consensus. They say consider ghibah to be one of the serious sins, haram. And the majority of them considers ghibah to be of the major sins. Major sins meaning that by performing my Fajr Salah and my Dhuhr Salah or my Jum'ah Salah today, while following one Salah with another, remove sins that take place between those Salahs. It doesn't remove a major sin. So I can do all I want, I can give charity, I can perform my Salah, I can be doing the best of deeds. But if I don't seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for speaking ill of my Muslim brother, there's no forgiveness for me. And I'm going to be held accountable in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may Allah protect us, may those words not apply to us, may we not fall deep in the fire of Jahannam for speaking ill of another Muslim. May it not be that our faces are flung first into the fire of Jahannam on account of that which our tongues harvested. You know, so it's a serious topic, Jamaatul Muslimin, that we should pay much attention to. Sometimes Shaitan has a tendency to trick us. So we do ghibah, imagining that I'm not. So Imam Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him, he says of the subtle forms of ghibah, when you and I think we're fooling Allah, but we're not. And Allah knows what is in our hearts. He says we mention a person's name, and in the same breath mentioning his name, I say, may Allah pardon us. So I say, you know that Buddha, whatever the Buddha's name is, Buddha Zaid, by way of example, you know that Buddha Zaid, oh, may Allah overlook us, may Allah pardon us. I'm not saying anything about him, but I'm indicating to something about him. And therefore I say, may Allah pardon us. It's a form of ghibah. It's a form of speaking ill of your Muslim brother. Allah yatub alayna, may Allah forgive us. Nas'alullah salama, may Allah protect us. I mention the man's name and I say, may Allah protect us. It's an indication to that man might possibly did something wrong. I'm trying to allude to that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take me to task for that. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he alluded to the same thing. He said sometimes we give the impression that we are somewhat astonished by the deed or the absence of a deed. But it's actually an act of ghibah. So I say in a sense of amusement or astonishment, you know that man, he drove past the masjid door time and he didn't even come in. I'm perhaps not speaking ill of him directly, but I'm alluding to something again. And again it's ghibah. And again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to take me to task for that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا. Let one Muslim not speak ill of his other Muslim. Let him not make ghibah of another Muslim. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on and he says that, أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَن يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِحْتُمُ. Are one of you happy and pleased with eating the flesh of his brother when he is dead? فَكَرِحْتُمُ. Allah says, you dislike it. But speaking ill about him is like eating his flesh. This is Allah speaking to us in his Quran. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in more than one hadith emphasizes the honor of a believer. And I'm stressing this point, Jamaatul Muslimin, because we are living in a time where I think absolutely nothing of speaking ill of another Muslim. It's become part of our custom. It's become part of our society. It's become part of our social gathering. You know, the gathering is not complete until I start speaking about another person. You know, sometimes I have absolutely nothing to say. My whole life goes by speaking about others. If I meet somebody and I don't have something to tell you about another person, I have nothing to say to you. This is the condition that our community has reached. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said emphatically, "Inna dima'akum, the wealth, the blood of your Muslim brother, wa amwalakum, your wealth, your honor, is haram. The wealth of a Muslim brother is haram for you. His honor is haram for you. His blood is haram for you. Rasulullah said, "Ka hurmati yomikum hada," as sacred as this day is, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was referring to a Friday, if my memory serves me correctly, fi shahrikum hadha, in this holy month, and the Prophet was in the month of Muharram. As sacred as this month is, as sacred as the day of Jumu'ah is, so sacred is the wealth of a Muslim brother. So sacred is the blood of a Muslim brother. So sacred is the honor of a Muslim brother. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala, and the Prophet did not stop short. You know, this is problems we have in our homes. You know, Rasulullah didn't allow his own wives to engage in ghibah. When Aisha radiallahu ta'ala made a statement one day in the company of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet she made a statement. And she said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hasbuka min safiyyat anna qasira. You know, it suffices you regarding your wife Safiya that she's a short lady. It wasn't even say an extremely bad thing. And one could possibly argue that it was maybe the truth. But she said it in a negative way. She said it in a way that Safiya would not have been happy with the statement. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reprimanded her. And he said to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala, he said to her, لَقَدْ كُلْتِ كَلِمَةً. You have uttered now such a word. لَوْ مُزِجَتْ بِمَاءِ الْبَحْرِ لَمَزَجَتْهُ. You have uttered such a filthy word. Should that word be turned into a liquid and thrown into the oceans of this world, it will stain the oceans of this world. That's how bad a single word of ghibah is. So if ghibah has an impact and spoils the oceans of the world, then what about my handful of good deeds that I have performed in my life? What is ghibah going to do to my good deeds? What will ghibah do to my salah and to my sadaqah and my... You know, our scholars say that the most harmful thing to our good deeds is speaking ill of other Muslims. So make your tahajjud, your sadaqah, your salah, your masjid. But speaking ill of a Muslim brother spoils your actions. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you uttered such a word, should it be thrown into the oceans, it would spoil the oceans. Lamazajatu. You know, these are serious advices that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is giving us here in this beautiful hadith. I want to mention, Jamaatul Muslimin, some of the causes why we engage in ghibah. Bawa'it al-ghibah. What causes us to speak ill of our Muslim brothers? And the first reason, Jamaatul Muslimin, is going to be da'ful wara' wal iman. The fact that our iman is weak. The fact that we lack piety. Someone who has belief, strong iman, and piety, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take me to task for speaking about my Muslim brother. Such a person will not do so. If he knows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it's like eating the flesh of your Muslim brother. If he knows that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, that if your word of ghibah should be thrown into the ocean, it would spoil the ocean. Such a person cannot do it. He cannot go against the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He cannot go against the instruction of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second reason, and I actually want to rush through this, Jamaatul Muslimin, why we tend to speak ill of others is murafaqatul aqrani wal julasa. We're keeping the wrong company. We're keeping the wrong company. If the company I hold is a company that is constantly speaking ill of another person, then it means that company is bad for me. I shouldn't look for such company. I should avoid such company. And if I find myself in such company, I need to make excuses to leave that company. Because I don't want to be in company where my deeds are going to be spoiled. Where all my salah is going to go down the drain, and my sadaqah, etc. My umrah that I performed, and the hajj that I performed. You know, so one of the main causes is keeping the wrong company. May Allah protect us from such company. وَكُنَّا نَخُوذُ مَعَ الْخَائِدِينَ. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us that whoever seeks the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the anger of Allah, Allah subhanahu, and what the Prophet is referring to here is that bad company. So I imagine that by keeping the company of people, I'm visiting a Muslim brother, I'm keeping friendship with a Muslim brother. But at the same time, when I'm in that company, I'm speaking ill of other Muslims. You know, this is what the hadith refers to. So whoever seeks the pleasure of Allah through the anger of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wakkalahu, will entrust him to those people. Let those people assist you and help you. Those people whose company you kept, that took you away from Allah, that spoiled your deeds on account of speaking ill of others. Another reason, Jamaatul Muslimin, is jealousy. And these are all sicknesses and ailments of the heart. When I'm jealous of another, I don't want to hear good being spoken of that person. So when they speak good of the person, I want to tell you, you know, don't think too much about him. He doesn't do this. You know, I don't see him praying in Jama'ah. Don't speak too good about him. I don't see him spending in the way of Allah. No, it's jealousy that causes one again to speak ill of another Muslim. The idea of seeking to be better than others, which is connected to jealousy. So Fudayl ibn Iyad, he said that ما من أحد أحب الرياسة إلا حسد وبغى. There's no person who seeks leadership, wants to be on top of everyone else. He wants to portray himself as the best. He wants to portray himself as if he is better. Except that you find such a person, حسد. He starts developing envy towards others. وبغى, he starts being oppressive. وتتبع عيوب الناس وكره أن يذكر أحد بخير. He starts following the faults of others, and he dislikes that good must be spoken about another person in his company. So he turns your attention away from the other, and he wants you to be focused on him. And I do all of that. So I say, you know, mashallah, a person is reading tahajjud salah. I say, I also make tahajjud. There's nothing good about that. Sometimes, if for me to mention my actions as an encouragement for another person, bismillah, no problem. But if my intention is to take an intention away from another person, because I don't want that person to be thought good of, then it's a form of ghiba that we should stay clear from. The manner in which we rid ourselves and free ourselves from this dangerous sin, Jamaatul Muslimin, there are a number of points that our scholars mention, how a person actually prevents himself from entering into ghiba and speaking ill of others. And I merely want to mention one or two of them here, بإذن الله سبحانه وتعالى, is that أن يتذكر عيوبه. Before you mention the bad of another, look into yourself and ask yourself, how much bad do I have in my life? Imagine Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to expose me. I want to expose my Muslim brother. Imagine Allah exposes me. How fortunate should I be that Allah is keeping my sins covered. Allah is not letting other people know of the wrong that I've done in my life. So let me rather not speak ill of another person before Allah exposes me. And this is an important thing that I should constantly remind myself. Before I open my mouth and speak about another, what if Allah should expose me? What happens to my life if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should expose my sins? Another thing, Jamaatul Muslimin, and this is something that many of us might have experienced. You know, Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu says that I've reached people in the city of Medina al-Munawwar aqwaman lam yakun lahum uyub. They had no faults. They were pure people. They had no faults, no defects, no sins, nothing. But then they started speaking about the ills of others. They started pointing out the ailments and the sicknesses and the sins of other people. And not too long thereafter, you found those same sins and evils within them. And this is something that you need to tell yourself. If I'm going to speak about the ill of another person, then it's not very far for Allah to allow that sin to come into my life. If I don't want that sin in my life, let me not speak about the sin of another individual. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. The most important thing, Jamaatul Muslimin, I feel, and this needs to be emphasized when it comes to ridding ourselves of this evil, of speaking ill of others, is keeping the company of the pious. Now, that's how Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in the authentic hadith. That once the person, مَثَلُ الْجَلِيسِ الصَّالِحِ وَالْجَلِيسِ السُّوءِ, that the parable or the example of a pious man's company who you keep, or a bad person's company who you keep, كَمَثَلِ صَاحِبِ الْمِسْكِ, as like you're keeping the company of someone who sells musk, or you're keeping the company of a blacksmith. If you keep the company of the one selling musk, eventually when you leave his shop, you also smell good. But if you keep the company of the blacksmith, eventually once you leave his workshop, you also start smelling bad. No, so the company of the pious, the effects of the character, the effects of the qualities, it rubs off on you. So one of the most important things to do, Jamaatul Muslimin, in getting rid of all types of evil, is keeping the company of the pious. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us that. The last point I really want to come to, Jamaatul Muslimin, and this was actually my original idea, that what I wanted to address today, is covering the faults. Another reason how I can prevent myself from speaking ill of others, keep in mind the importance of covering the faults of your Muslim brother. Keep in mind there's two things: covering your own faults and covering the faults of your Muslim brother. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in an authentic hadith narrated by Imam Muslim, rahimahullah ta'ala, la yasturu 'abdun 'abdan fi dunya. There's no slave, there's no believer who covers the faults of his Muslim brother in this world, except that Allah will cover his faults on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. What is our state on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah? Who doesn't need Allah to cover our faults on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah? There's no slave, believing slave, it covers the faults of his Muslim brother in this world, except Allah covers his faults on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. I want to ask the Jama'ah, what is the unspoken word? If our Prophet says the person who covers the faults of a Muslim in this world, Allah covers his faults in the year after, so what is the state of a person who exposes his Muslim brother? What is the state of a person who speaks ill of his Muslim brother? And by speaking ill of him, you're exposing him. What will his state be on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah? Allah will expose him. And this is what our Prophet wasallam is saying to us over here. You know, so covering the faults of a Muslim brother, Jamaat al-Muslimin, is an important thing. Another thing under the topic of satr, covering faults and covering sins, is that a believer should cover his own sins. If you did anything wrong, then you cannot go and boast to others about the wrong that you've done. That's an ignorant person. Our Prophet ﷺ, again in a hadith narrated by Imam Bukhari and Muslim, he says that kulla ummati mu'afan. My entire ummah will be pardoned. Illa al-mujahirin, except the mujahir. So the companions want to know, Ya Rasulullah, who is the mujahir? And the Prophet ﷺ, he says, a mujahir is a person, he commits a sin at night. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he enters mourning, وَقَدْ سَتَرَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. Allah has covered his fault. He enters mourning and Allah has covered his fault. Nobody knows about it. But then he goes around to people and he starts boasting. Last night, you know what we did in town and what we did at the hotel? He's exposing himself. Allah forgives everyone except that person who exposes himself to people. So our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَقَدْ بَاتَ يَسْتُرُهُ رَبُّهُ وَيُكْسِيُصْبِحُهُ يَكْشِفُ سِتْرَ اللَّهِ. He spends the night and Allah covered his faults, and in the morning he wakes up, he unveils the covering that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed over his deeds. In a hadith Qudsi, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informs us that a man will stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. And this is how merciful and compassionate Allah is. And the man says that Allah will say to this individual that you remember such and such a sin. And he will confirm and say, Ya Allah, I remember that sin. And how could you lie to Allah on that day? And Allah will say to us, you remember such and such a sin. ذَنْبَ كَذَا وَكَذَا. And he will say, فَيُقِرُّ. He will confirm the sin that he committed. And Allah will continue saying, you remember this sin and that sin and that sin and that sin. Till eventually the man is convinced that he's destroyed. Today I'm unsuccessful. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to this person that as how I have covered and kept the sins of you secret in this world, I will keep it a secret on this day and then we enter into Jannah. You know, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He doesn't want us to speak of the wrong. Never mind uncovering the faults of others, we should not uncover our own faults, says our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. So Jamaatul Muslimin, these are some advices that I wish to share with the Jama'ah regarding ghibah. Recapping that it is something that is evil, it is something that is bad, it is something that we should stay away from. It's that thing that will cause the greatest harm to our actions. There's nothing that spoil our deeds as how speaking ill of others will spoil our deeds. The punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is severe for that person who speaks ill of his Muslim brother. In conclusion, Jamaatul Muslimin, in the 2-3 minutes that I have left, just some guidance with regards to the passing on of our previous and ex-president of South Africa, Nelson Mandela. And this is important to speak about because our Muslims sometimes, again in line with this topic of controlling our tongues, sometimes we don't know what to say. You know, there's never a time when I feel that freedom of expression is a bad thing when you see Muslims on social networks saying things that they're not supposed to be saying. You know, there's a time and place for everything. A time when a country loses a hero. A time when a country loses a president that has done so much for you and I. You know, and some of the seniors in the masjid that live in that era of oppression, they would know best what type of sacrifices our previous president went through. You know, there's no harm in speaking of the good that he has done. To send your condolences to the family of non-believers. To speak of the good that they've done in this world, it's minas sunnah, from the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The father of Jubair ibn Mut'im, al-Mut'im ibn Adi, he died as a disbeliever. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam praised him, even after he passed on. There's no harm in speaking good of a person, even if he died as a disbeliever. Mut'im ibn Adi, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam returned from Ta'if, after he was rejected by the chieftains and after they pelted him out of Ta'if, Mut'im ibn Adi was that person who gave the Prophet some protection when he returned into Makkah. And he himself stood as a bodyguard to ensure that no one harms the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he returned to Makkah, he performed tawaf of the Kaaba, he prayed two raka'ats in front of the Kaaba, and Mut'im ibn Adi, he was a person who stood there. And he said, no one harms Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam today. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam praised him for that. When the Battle of Badr took place, 2-3 years later, and the Muslims, they took a large amount of captives, the Asara of Badr, the prisoners of war. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made a statement, and he said that had Mut'im ibn Adi, that person who died as a disbeliever, had he been alive today, and were he to seek intercession for all these prisoners, I would let them all go free on based on the intercession of Mut'im ibn Adi. And he was a disbeliever. He died as a disbeliever, but it did not stop Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from speaking of the good that he has done, for praising him for the good that he has done. And everyone in this country, Jamaatul Muslimin, without a doubt, we are indebted to that person who passed away yesterday. He led the struggle against oppression. He led the struggle against apartheid. You know, so we are indebted to him. We should speak well of him. We should praise him for the good that he has done. And we stop over there. We send our condolences to his family and we stop over there. Now is not the time for other speech, Jamaatul Muslimin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower his mercy and rahmah upon us. May he allow us to protect this limb. This limb that Imam Ghazali said, its size is very small, but the sin it carries is great. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to control our tongues. You know, so we control our tongues, and if we do so, our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam guaranteed, he guaranteed, he said, Adman, I guarantee that the person who controls his tongue will enter Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from them. Wa bihadha al-qadr naktafi. Wa akhir da'wana. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.